We've been doing these I am statements. There's seven I am statements in the Gospel of John. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. Today we're going to look at that I am the good shepherd. I am the good shepherd out of chapter 10. So again, turn with me to John chapter 10. If you're using a house Bible, it's on page 896. John was one of Jesus's closest friends. So he writes from a first-person point of view that he was engaged when these things took place. In my later 20s, I was beginning to get a platform where I was traveling and speaking some in the student ministry world, in colleges and high schools and middle schools and conferences and retreats. And I got a very plum opportunity. I was invited to speak at the National Youth Workers Convention. Being a youth guy, it was kind of, this was the place to go. And it could have very well sent me on a speaking career. I was at the airport in Philadelphia. I was pastoring out in Philly, out by the main, what's called the main line by Villanova University that got beat yesterday by Purdue, but that's another thing for another day. I'm not bitter. And I'm at Philadelphia Airport, and I literally have my ticket in hand, and I'm about to hand it over to step, walk down the walkway and onto the plane when I hear, and this will tell you how long ago it was, white courtesy telephone, right? Jackson Crum, please call the white courtesy telephone. Please call the use the white courtesy telephone. So I step out of line, and I walk down, and I pick the phone up, and the message came back to me, Jackson, you need to call your office. So I called my executive pastor, who is my boss, and just said to him, Woody, what's up? And he said, Keith McNutt died. Now, being a student pastor, Keith was one of my students. He was 16 years old, and he died in his sleep. He just didn't wake up. I had just had dinner the previous week with Keith, and we had had a very good conversation. So I was assured of where he was, and I was assured of his faith. But I had a decision to make at that point, standing in Philadelphia Airport. Was I going to get on that plane and go to this conference and be a keynote speaker, or was I going to go back and sit with this family? I had never done a funeral before. I was a really young pastor. I had never done a funeral. Never chatted with parents who had lost a kid. And for me, it was one of those moments when God solidified for me what the call was on my life. That it was not to be a speaker, it was to be a pastor. And I got in my car, and I drove home. Sat with that family, did this funeral. Knew the family, knew the mother really well, and the dad. And just heartbreaking, heartbreaking. But it reminded me of the importance of what it means to be engaged as a shepherd in people's lives. And we're going to talk about that this morning. What does it mean to be a shepherd? What does it mean to be shepherded by the great shepherd? And what does it mean for us to shepherd and be engaged in people's lives? So let me pray and we'll jump in. Father God, we invite you in this space. Of course, we know you're everywhere all the time, but that invitation is really for us. Lord, we're asking you, will you speak to us? Will you whisper in our ear? Will you nudge us in our heart? We desperately need to hear from you. Father, I would pray that anything I would say that is not of you, as I pray every time I'm up here, would it quickly be forgotten? I will only tend to confuse. But Father, I claim the promise in Isaiah 55 that says, your words never return to you without you accomplishing your agenda. And we trust that right here in this moment. And may we not just be merely hearers of your word, as James says, but may we put it into practice, Lord. May we live differently in our relationship towards you and then our relationship with each other. And with our heads bowed, let me encourage you to maybe just pray this morning. Jesus, teach me to be a good sheep as you are my good shepherd. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me just remind you the context of what's going on here. As we talked about 2 weeks ago, there was a blind man that Jesus healed. He spit in some mud, wiped it in the man's eyes, and the man walked down to the pool of Siloam. He comes back, and the religious leaders of the day, who were called Pharisees, who they were lay people, religious lay people, they begin to press him. They wanted to know, do you believe he is the Christ, which literally is translated as Messiah, or anointed one? Do you believe he's the one? And he eventually goes, yeah, I do. And they excommunicated, and they kicked him out of the synagogue, which was really the center of the life for a Jewish person. And Jesus found him and talked with him. And now what you have is you have the blind man standing here. You have the religious leaders, the Pharisees standing here. And over here you've got Jesus' disciples. So Jesus begins to have a dialogue. Really, it's a soliloquy. Jesus begins to say some things to these religious leaders, but at the same time as he speaks to the blind man, his disciples. So look with me at verse 1. And we're going to back up and cover some ground Steve did last week just to make sure we get the context. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers. This figure of speech, this metaphor Jesus used with them, but they didn't understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus again said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, I'm the door of the sheep, and all who come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy, and I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. Now let me pause there. Jesus is speaking strongly to these religious leaders. We'll see at the end, if you keep reading through this text, we won't have time to today. Some understand exactly what he's saying and others don't. Jesus is making a comparison between them and him. Now, what Jesus is saying about a sheep and a shepherd is not unusual. Let me show you. Here's a number of places in the Old Testament where this metaphor is used of God engaging with his people, where God is the shepherd and his people are the sheep. Psalm 23, a famous one, really speaks about God being the shepherd. So when Jesus says that he's the shepherd, when he takes this motif and applies it to himself, it's a way in which, a very Hebraic way, a very Jesus way of him saying, I am deity, I am God. These passages are applying to me. Now, sheep and shepherds, a very common motif in that day. Very common. It'd be like me using a car as an illustration. We all immediately understand how a car, what a car does and the use of a car. When Jesus calls us sheep, when God calls us sheep, it's not a compliment. Don and I had a very good friend who was a shepherd for several years, and I called him a while back to talk to him about what it was like being a shepherd. He said, Jackson, when God was giving out brain, sheep didn't show up. They are stubborn. They're skittish to the silliest thing. Sheep can tip over and have a hard time turning back upright. They will eat grass down to the dirt. They'll follow the same path to a field day after day, even though they've eaten all the grass down to the dirt, and they will pass a green pasture right here, and they'll just walk right on by. They are dumb as nails. When a sheep gives birth, my friend was telling a guy named Vernon, when a sheep gives birth, sometimes the mother forgets who the lamb is. And so the shepherd has to tie a string to the mom and the lamb so the mother can go, oh, yeah, right, you're mine. Got it, okay. So when we're called sheep, that's not necessarily a good thing. But sheep need a shepherd. Sheep need a good shepherd. And when we are sheep, we need a good shepherd. And that's what God has provided for us in Jesus. Look with me again at verse 11. I am the good shepherd. The shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd and who does not own the sheep sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf scatters them, snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he's a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I laid my life down for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this fold. Remember, he's speaking to Jewish folks, so he's talking about Gentiles, which are most of us. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice, and there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. Now, what makes Jesus a good shepherd? I just want us to go through, and let me show you a list we're going to be working off. This is from 1 to 17, various places where Jesus describes himself using that motif of being a shepherd and sheep. All right, here's the first one in verses 3 and 14. The good shepherd calls his sheep by name. A shepherd knows his sheep. In fact, he's so familiar with the sheep that he gives nicknames to the sheep. He has an affection for them, not unlike you may have for your dog, where you care for your dog and provide for your dog and have a name for your dog, that a shepherd would care deeply for his sheep. He would know them intimately. One Middle Eastern shepherd, when asked about how well he knew his sheep, said this: "If you were to put a cloth over my eyes and bring me in a sheep and only let me put my hands on his face, I could tell in a moment it was mine or not." The good shepherd knows us intimately. He knows our name. And frankly, the privilege is we know his name. He knows the details of our life. He has not lost sight for a moment of anything that matters to us as he moves into this relationship, this intimate relationship with us. All right, let's go back and look at that list. In verse 4 and 14, it says, "The sheep know the good shepherd's voice. Because of the time the shepherd spends with the sheep, they recognize the voice." Again, not unlike your family dog. When you call and they respond, they know your voice. There was a time when Don and I were in the Middle East. You know that I love going to biblical lands. And I was standing there watching two shepherds out in an open field that came together. And they pulled out their cigarettes and they're smoking. And the sheep begin to intermingle. And then the guy flicks his cigarette out and he begins to walk and he goes, "Ay, ay, 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 ay." And just about half the sheep begin to turn and walk. The other ones didn't move. They knew that voice. They knew that call. They had a relationship with the shepherd that he used every time he wanted to call them, and they go, "That's our guy." We know the voice of Jesus. In fact, it's a Hebrew idiom which means we obey. We hear the voice, we seek to obey. When Jesus speaks to us through his word, when Jesus speaks through us through the power of the Spirit that engages in us because we're followers of Christ, we listen, we know, we are to respond to him because he is our good shepherd. Verse 3 and verse 4, it says, "The good shepherd leads them out. The good shepherd goes before them." Let me show you a picture. In the Middle East, you don't drive your sheep, you lead your sheep. Why? Because the sheep trust that you know where you're going. You're going to lead them to a safe place. They're going to line up behind the shepherd because the shepherd is the one that is there to provide for them, to care for them. So the shepherd leads. The shepherd goes before them. It's the responsibility of the shepherd to engage in this very important way for the sheep. And don't we do the same? We line ourselves up behind Jesus. Jesus, you lead in our life. You are the one who is in charge of our lives. We submit to you because we trust you. You will not take us to places we should not go. Verse 7, we look at that list again. The good shepherd is the door to the sheep pen. And Steve did a good job talking about this last week. Let me show you what a sheep pen looks like. Down here at the bottom right would have been one for a village where various sheep would have been put in for the night, and the other one would have been one you would create out in the wild. You'd put your sheep in there at night. You notice there's no gate, no door, because the shepherd's job was to sleep in the door. He is the door. The sheep come through him. The sheep can't leave because he's there to protect them. It says thieves and robbers can't get in. The wolf can't get in. That the sheep feel safe because the shepherd sits at the door. Well, the motif for us, Jesus says, is that we enter through him into the sheep pen. We enter into safety. We're under the covering of Jesus. We no longer stand under the judgment of God because we have passed through the door through Jesus. And we are now in a safe place because of Christ, our good shepherd. The good shepherd in verse 9 shows the green pastures, it says. See, it's the shepherd's job to know where to go. Shepherds would be out for weeks at a time. In the summer times, they would go to the high hills. In the winter time, they would go down to the low hills. Now, when we think of green pastures in Psalm 23, he leads us to green pastures. We think of Iowa. Let me show you what it looks like in Israel. There's this phenomena that grass comes up in the early morning and the dew waters the grass, but by midday it's burnt out. It's the job of the shepherd to know where this grass is growing. And he drives the sheep or brings the sheep along so that they can be fed, that they can be protected, the green pastures. Jesus brings us into green pastures. He brings us into a relationship. He feeds us, as we talked about a couple of weeks ago. Jesus is the bread of life, and we engage with him. We know life from him. We get our substance from him. As we move forward, we also see in verse 11 and 15 and 12 and 13 that the good shepherd lays his life down for the sheep. He protects the sheep. The good shepherd is not a hireling. He's not a hired hand. What would happen is that in a village, you might only have four or five sheep, and you would go together with a bunch of other families, and you would hire a shepherd who would take care of your sheep. And there's reports that you can read from the day that many times what would happen after the end of a couple of weeks, the shepherd would come back, and he'd be two sheep short. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry, wolf got him. And really what had happened is he sold them. He didn't care for the sheep. They're not his sheep. In fact, there's stories of also wolves showing up. And in the days of Jesus, believe it or not, there were lions and there were bears that lived in Israel. And when something like that showed up, he's out of here. They're not my sheep. They're not paying me enough for this job. Think about it. We live the same way. We don't treat things we rent like we do things we own. And Jesus says, I'm not going to run. When the wolf shows up, let me show you a picture. I'm not going to run. In fact, the shepherd had tools. Trent, let's go to that next picture. The shepherd had tools. And he had tools. One was a rod, a staff, and a slingshot. The rod was 2 to 4 feet long with a knob at the end, and many times they'd put nails on it, what they could use with a wild animal. Or they would have this staff that would be 6 feet tall that they would use to walk with, or they would use to drive off a wild animal, or they would use to whack on the tail of a lamb or a sheep that was going the wrong way. Back this way, bud. A slingshot. We know this because of the story of David and Goliath and Samuel, where David used a slingshot because he'd become an expert, because he was a shepherd. Jesus stands as the one who owns the sheep. He's not a hireling. When things get tough, he doesn't run. In fact, what he does, he steps in the place when the wolf approaches and he puts us behind him. And he says, I will deal with this. I will take care of this for you. The severe wolves in our lives have been dealt with by the one who is the good shepherd. Look with me again at verse 11. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. This is what makes Jesus the good shepherd. It's what separates him from religious leaders of his day, or frankly of our day. His willingness to lay his life down for the sheep. To lay his life down against robbers and thieves, against wolves. Look with me at verse 17. For this reason the Father loves me, because I laid down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own accord. I have authority to lay it down. I have authority to take it up again. Here's what's interesting. The shepherd becomes a sheep and dies. It appears that the wolf has conquered and devoured the sheep. What's the wolf? Our resistance, our rejection of God, our sin, as the Bible uses the word. Jesus steps into the place, and the wolf of sin seems to devour him on the cross. He dies. The shepherd becomes a sheep and he dies. But, what's it say? I lay my life down, but I also take it up again. And the shepherd comes back after 3 days. He's raised from the dead. That's our Good Friday. That's our Easter. That's exactly what's happening. It's Jesus pointing forward to his disciples. The day will come. I will lay my life down, but, I'll raise it up again. The good shepherd lays his life down for the wolves so that we might know life and live in green pastures. He does for us what we could not do for ourselves. Now, questions that we ought to consider as we think about and we hear this, what we need to recognize is that Jesus, remember, is talking to the false teachers. He's talking to these religious leaders, and he's saying to them, you aren't this way. You don't care for the flock. Look how you treated the blind man. You wouldn't lay your life down for him. You excommunicated him. In contrast to that, look at me, the good shepherd. So how does God continue to shepherd his flock today with Jesus being at his right hand? How does Jesus shepherd the church? He raises up shepherds to shepherd on his behalf. Sheep are anyone within the faith community who has a need. Every one of us are sheep. Shepherds are anyone who has a spiritual responsibility for one of these sheep. Who are our shepherds? Let me show you a list of some. Elders, pastors, directors, deacons, team leaders, loop leaders, student ministry leaders, small group leaders, apprentices, mentors, parents, nannies. Don't they all have some kind of responsibility for sheep? In the church, first and foremost, it's the elders of the church who are the shepherds. Let me remind you what one of Jesus' closest friends named Peter wrote, and he wrote this. He wrote a letter to a group of churches in the middle part of Turkey today. In 1 Peter 5, he says, "So I exhort the elders among you as a fellow elder, shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory." Another way of saying is Peter saying, you're going to be held accountable for the job you do. Elders cannot know every sheep in a church. It doesn't matter how big or small the church is. The responsibility of an elder is to make sure that every person is known by someone. To know those who want to be known. And if I may, just aside, some of you just come and go and come and go, and you don't feel engaged here. You don't give us the privilege to know you, to be responsible for you, to love you. And I would encourage you, if that's your story, make yourself known so we can come along your side and walk with you as well. Let me show you the elders. Here's the church-wide elders. They live at a 30,000-foot level, looking at all 10 of our locations, thinking about budget, vision, staffing, teaching, all kind of issues that are going on. They kind of work at a 30,000-foot level. And then each location, each of our 10 locations, will have elders that are then on the ground, engaged on a daily basis, and caring and teaching and coming along their side. Here's what Near North's elders look like. Here's the four, and we're probably going to add two more to make sure that we have enough that are available to be engaged here at Near North. It's so important that the people, that sheep, are shepherded well. Why did God give us shepherds? So we would know that we are loved and cared for by the good shepherd. You're not our sheep. We just work for the guy who you do belong to. We're responsible to him. Every shepherd is to point to the greater shepherd. Every shepherd is to make sure that you know and can understand what an abundant life looks like. Look with me at the second half of verse 10. Jesus said, "I came that they might have life and have it abundantly." Using this sheep motif, what's an abundant life for a sheep? Green grass, protection, calm water, no wild animals attacking them. What does it mean for you and me in abundant life? That we are engaged in knowing and living out a relationship with the good shepherd. Shepherds feel responsible for the sheep, not in place of the good shepherd, but on behalf of the good shepherd. What makes a good shepherd then? What makes a good shepherd? Before any of us are a shepherd, we start off by being a sheep. We become a sheep by walking through the door, by engaging in a relationship with Jesus. We hear his voice. We know his voice. We seek to obey. Remember, I told you that's a Hebrew idiom meaning to obey. We listen and we know and we seek to obey. What makes a good shepherd? Shepherds that are engaged with the sheep, where they smell like sheep. When we were in the Middle East once, there was a shepherd walking around, and I kind of walked as close as I could without looking too obvious. I just kind of wanted to know what he was like. Oh, did he smell? He smelled like his sheep. He spent the days and days and days with them. Of course, that's what he smelled like. And a good shepherd is engaged with the sheep. He's listening. He's asking questions. He knows the sheep. He's encouraging. And at times he's confronting because he knows the needs of the sheep. David, second king of Israel and the greatest king of Israel, was a shepherd as a young man. And he wrote in the book of Psalms. Psalms is 150 poems that talk about all kinds of issues in life. And the one that we number is 78. He says in verse 72 of this, he goes, "With upright heart he shepherded them and guided them with his skillful hand." What does that mean? A shepherd has an upright heart. It means he has character. His character is being transformed in the character and likeness of Jesus. He thinks and acts more and more like the good shepherd. Shepherds on earth are not perfect, but we are to be credible. We're not perfect, but we should be credible. People should see who we are. One of the things I've found over the years, being a pastor and also being a parent, people catch more what I do than what I say. Same in your life. People catch more of what you do than what you say. What does it mean for us to live a life of character, modeling the good shepherd? Our lives should align with who he is. Shepherds are to be servants. We are to seek to serve before seeking to be served. And it's really important that shepherds don't seek to find their value from the sheep. Too many times it can be a shepherd and go, "Oh, well, I want to be needed. I want to feel important. I want to have authority. I want to have a position." Man, that is dangerous. If we are looking that way to use the sheep to make us successful, the sheep will not feel loved and cared for. Instead, we find our value from the good shepherd who says, "I know you and I love you and I've received you and forgiven you and included you and empowered you." When a shepherd knows that he is fully loved by the good shepherd, now he's not looking for that from the sheep, and he's able to care for them well. He's able to engage with them well. He's able to have the hard conversations that he might need to have well. Look at the second part of this, and we'll put it back up here, Psalm 78. Guided them with a skillful hand. That a shepherd has a skillful hand. What does he do? He provides and he protects. How do we provide for the sheep? We feed the sheep. We provide through the feeding, the green pastures of the word, not just here, but in a small group, in a mentoring relationship. What you do at home with your kids, parents, it's all teaching. You are a shepherd to them. What does it mean for you to teach them, to provide for them? And not only provide, but also to protect them. Matthew 7:15, Jesus says to his guys, he goes, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves." It is part of the shepherd's job to identify false teaching, to identify that person who comes in and wants to disrupt the flock. It's the responsibility of the shepherds to step in between that person and the sheep. We protect. We help protect you by having hard conversations around things that you may be doing. And remember, I'm a sheep, and people have had these conversations with me that shepherd me and care for me. We're willing to ask the hard questions. But may I remind you, sheep, may I remind you, your shepherds are not perfect. They will hurt you, not that they mean to, but they will hurt you. They will fail you. They will not say things perfectly for you. Their timing won't be exactly what you needed. And I will tell you that most of the time, that is not something they intended at all. Sometimes we say harsh things. I had a young man in my office, early 20s, who came in and just bruised by the church, bruised by a particular leader. And he shared with me that this leader said something to him. He had making some dumb decisions in his early 20s, and this leader looked at him, this leader of the church says, "I am so glad you're not my son." The pain, the scar. Sometimes as shepherds, we say things and do things that are hurtful. We bruise. And frankly, sometimes the sheep need to hear from us as shepherds, I am sorry. Will you forgive me? I am sorry. Last night after our Saturday night service, a young woman in her young 20s came up and started sharing with me about a bruise she got from another church 5 years ago, but has lingered with her. And I put my arms on her shoulders and I looked at her and I go, I'm sorry. On behalf of the church, will you forgive us? I am sorry. And she just began to weep. That's all she needed to hear. And some of us as sheep, we need to hear those words. Will you forgive me? I am sorry that I've hurt you. How are we as sheep to respond to the shepherds? Shepherds have a very high calling. Let me put up Hebrews 13 here for a second. Remember your leaders, those who spoke to you the word of God. Consider, that word in the Greek is examine the outcome of their way of life and imitate, where we get our word mimic, their faith. Hebrews 13, 17, obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls. And look at this next phrase, and those who will have to give an account, as those who will have to give an account. Shepherds, we will be held accountable. Let them do this with joy and not with groaning, because you're a pain in the rear, for that would be of no advantage to you. Sorry, that's the Jackson Crumb Study Bible. But look what it says here that we are to do as sheep. We are to consider our shepherds. We are to imitate their faith, not perfectly, credibly. We are to submit and obey them as those who are be held accountable for our very lives before the great shepherd. And if I may just be so blunt, some of us are difficult to lead. One of the motifs you also see in the Bible, Jesus uses it in the book of Matthew. He talks about the difference between goats and sheep. Let me show you a picture of goats. Goats don't follow well. We talk about herding cats in the Middle East. You would talk about herding goats. They don't follow well. They do what they want to do. And some of us live more like goats than we do sheep. We make it hard on our shepherds. Last night after service, I was chatting with a man who is a small group leader, and he was sharing that very thing, just hard, how hard it is at times to lead and to engage and to care when people are unresponsive. Why is it so hard for some of us to be willing, all right, here are the words, to obey and submit? Why is it so hard? The struggle that some of us have in submitting to the shepherds is really an issue of trusting. It really is at the heart of us, is we have an issue with trusting. We have believe we have plenty of reasons not to trust authority, and we can look at a culture and see where we have been disappointed over and over again. The media, entertainment business, big business, parents in college entrance, religion, the church. We've seen the failures, the cover-ups. There's a growing trend in America where more and more people will not call themselves churchgoers or religious, but they will call themselves spiritual as they try to separate themselves from the church. Some of us distrust all authority unless it's ourselves. We don't trust because we don't think we need a shepherd. We are good. We're good on our own. Until a wolf shows up. The loss of a job, the unexpected illness, a hurtful breakup. Now we want a shepherd. Trust comes down to really what it is you're trusting in. Is what you're trusting in trustworthy? Trust the good shepherd. Look at his character. Look at his person. Trust those who exhibit the character of the good shepherd. Not perfectly, but credibly. And don't we know Jesus to be a trustworthy person? Don't we know that he lived out what he taught and what he said? He protected the abused. He cared for the poor. He challenged the religious norms of the day. He lived as a minimalist. He was a mentor and a friend. He laid down his life for others. So how can we grow in trusting? We get to know the good shepherd. And then we begin to see the good shepherd and the shepherds that are around us, because we will see their lives line up. All right, I've turned third base and I'm heading home. Baseball season, yeah, come on. Shepherds, let me just speak to you for a moment. Sheep will hurt you. Sheep have teeth, and they will hurt you. They will say harsh things. They will criticize you. They will gossip about you. You will be misunderstood, and it hurts when you shepherd. This young man that I was talking to last night is going through something in a small group, and it's just very painful right now. Sometimes sheep are so hurting and needing, nothing seems to satisfy, and they take it out on the shepherd. In my early 20s, an older pastor who's about my age now took me out to coffee. And he looked at me as we were talking about being a pastor and what that means. He said, Jackson, you need to have the hide of a rhinoceros in a heart of a valentine. The hide of a rhinoceros in a heart of a valentine. He says, you will be hurt by those in the church. And man, nobody hurts like the church can hurt. Shepherds to sheep, sheep to shepherds. He says, but you can never lose the tenderness toward those God's entrusted to your care. You can never lose the love and the tenderness. And shepherds, I want you to know that you will be hurt by the sheep that are under your care. They will hurt you. They will bite you. Have a thick hide, but have a tenderness that says, I choose to love in spite of. I choose to love. Remember what your identity is. It is not in the words that they have for you. It is in the words that the great and good shepherd has already for you. You are known. You are loved. You are forgiven. You are received. You've been adopted. You are a son or a daughter of the King. That's who you are. I'm going to be standing down front here with Nate and a couple of other elders at the end of the service. And we did this after the last service, and I did it last night, and some of you might just want to come up and go, yes, I feel hurt by the church. Or some of you might come up as a shepherd and go, yes, I have been bitten, and I am still very tender, and I don't want to reengage. Let us pray with you. Let us talk with you. Let us begin the healing process with the sheep and the shepherd. Psalm 23, David writes that as he thinks about the God of the universe and how the God of the universe is engaging as the shepherd of the sheep. I'm going to put the words up here. I'm going to invite you to read these words with me. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We're going to receive communion. And when we receive communion, we're reminded that we come to a table that has been presented before us. A table that our good shepherd has presented. We come to a table where the shepherd has said, I've laid down my life for you. I have taken on the wolves for you. So that we would know forgiveness, that we would know reconciliation. Our table is open to any follower of Jesus. You don't have to be a regular attender here. You don't have to be what we call a partner here. If you're a follower of Christ, we invite you to come to the table of the good shepherd. But we would say, if you're not yet, walk through that door, the gate to the shepherd that sits there to protect you from all harm, and all the things that are difficult spiritually, sin and death and rebellion and resistance and rejection, then we would say to you, you shouldn't come, because it would not mean for you what God has intended it to mean. Unless today, maybe today is the day when God has connected those spiritual dots. He's pulled together all these different pieces that you've been learning about Jesus. And the day you understand he is your good shepherd, that he stands at the door and you are ready to say, I'm in spiritual need. That Jesus is my forgiver and that Jesus is my leader. We'll put a prayer up here on the screen. And maybe this prayer will communicate the desires of your heart. You can read it out loud or you can read it quietly where you sit. God can read your thoughts. And if you pray this prayer, then we invite you to come and to receive communion at the table of the shepherd, because you've walked through his door. So in just a moment after I pray, we'll invite you to come and get up from where you are and walk to one of our stations and take one of the wafers and dip it into the juice to remind yourself that the shepherd's body was broken and his blood was spilled so that you might know reconciliation, that you know that you have been restored into a right relationship with him. 1 Corinthians 11:23 says, Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord what I have delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Father God, we thank you that you have given us the good shepherd, the faithful one. He does not run like the hirelings. He does not avoid the wolf, but he has stepped in between us and protected us from the penalty of sin and death. And now we come to the table and we rejoice again as we eat the bread and drink from the cup, that the shepherd has laid his life down and picked it up so that we would have life. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to encourage you too. I know many of you like to slip out right now. Hang in there with us, because we're going to sing afterwards, and it's a time for us to celebrate the Great Shepherd.